In the name of the Father, and the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. The Lord today speaks to us about the fear of God. And he says, do not be afraid of those who will kill the body, which is, if you think about it a little bit, it's a little bit ironic, or a little bit shocking, actually, to think that the Lord will tell you something like this. You know, don't worry, they will just kill you. Don't worry, they will just kill you. And he said it will not do more. From the point of the Lord, to die, it's not the end of the story. But to us who have very little faith, we think death is the end of the story. And I keep saying this always, and I say and remind you, our life, actually the life of the world, is marked by death. Why people want to marry in a certain age and try very hard to get that done quickly? Why do you need to get a degree and work and establish yourself and make a place in the world and to have a chance? Why it has to be done in a certain time? When persons and people are delayed in doing that, what happens? They get anxious and they get frustrated and sometimes angry. Because our life is limited by death, but the Lord is saying, death does not limit your life. You're not limited by death. Don't worry about it. If you had no children in this world, if you had no luck in getting married or having a chance to develop a business or any of that stuff, that's not the end of it. Don't be so sad. And if people like martyrs, we heard a lot of martyrs without accomplishing anything. Martyrs died when they were little kids, teenagers, in their 20s, and they had not done anything. So the Lord said, don't be afraid of those who kill the body. But he says, I'll tell you who you should be afraid of. And I want us to really realize this today, because this is important. He's saying, be afraid, fear him who after he kills have the power to throw in hell. Who is that? Who is this person who has the power to throw people in hell? Don't tell me the devil. The devil has no power over anybody. Who is the one who has the absolute power over us? It's God. So the Lord says, have fear of God. But he balances this and he said, he counts all your hair. He cares a lot about us. There is a balance between the loving God and the fearful God. And we cannot have one and not the other. In the same gospel, he said that. He said, but I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who after him with a capital H, so the translation knows exactly what this means. Who after he with a capital H has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him. Sometimes people say, oh, to fear God, the fear of God means to respect God and just to kind of be respectful. No, I disagree. We should have some fear, real fear. It's terrible to be an enemy of God. It is really terrible. So let's not be enemies. How can you be an enemy of God? I'll tell you that the gospel is very clear. You are an enemy of God when you love the world. You are enemy of God when you love the world. The love of the world is enmity with God. What does the world have? Lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. I'll tell you when we are going to be enemies of God. When we want to have it easy all the time. We want to have the best of everything. We want to enjoy our life and forget about it. That's exactly it. We don't want to suffer anything for the sake of the kingdom. We are enemies of God. You say, Abuna, that's everybody. What do you think? I said, numbers doesn't make any difference. There was time when actually a flood wiped the whole earth. Numbers doesn't make difference with God. We cannot twist his arm. We're not stronger than him. But yes, he loves us. Big time love. Because he is righteous. God is righteous. He is love and power together. So he says, and then he goes to balance it. He says, are not five sparrows sold for 2 copper coins? He says, 5 little birds, those sparrows, are sold for 2 copper coins. Actually, in another place, he says 2 sparrows for 1. So two sparrows for one, five for two. What does that mean? There is one free. When you buy four, you should pay two. He gives you one on top. So that means one of them is actually not counted. Five sparrows for two copper coins. And yes, he said, and not one of them is forgotten before God. The seller, the one who gives you the sparrows, give you one extra as if it's not really important. Just take it. It's okay. But what God says, what Jesus says, that God doesn't really forget about that one sparrow. He doesn't really. He cares about it. And then, but the very hairs of your head are all numbers. We're much better than sparrows to him. Do not fear, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. More value on the whole, you know, one person in the eyes of God is more important than all the sparrows of the universe. So there is this balance between fear and love. Yes, he is the Father and he loves us. But I have to be careful what I'm doing and how I'm conducting myself, lest I become an enemy, not a child. To become an enemy in when you are selfish, when I am selfish, and we are only seeking to please ourselves, and there's no regard of God in my life at whatsoever. I look at my life and I see that there's no place for him, not whatsoever. All that I'm thinking about all day long is me, 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 me. That's it. When we read today the story of St. Isaiah, and that's a beautiful story, it's one of the rich hagiographies, the rich stories of saints, St. Isaiah the ascetic. He wrote a lot of books, and it's good to read some of his writings, beautiful. Yeah, we are not monks, you know, we're families living in the city, working every day and dealing with the world, but it benefits us to learn from them. Might not be able to do everything they're doing, but we might benefit from them some. How did they live their lives? Ascetics, they go against their moods. They go against their moods. So today you say, I'm in the mood to eat a steak. An ascetic would say, that's the day you should go vegan. I'm in the mood to go to the beach. And that's the day actually to stay at your room and open your Bible and read. That's ascetics. There is a man who wrote a book. I would recommend that book for us, not for the ascetics. His name is Tito Coleander. I don't know where he is from. Wrote a book called The Way of the Ascetics. So he starts this book and said, you're a married man and you live in the city and you go to work every day, but you want to practice some asceticism. So what should you do? He said the beginning of asceticism is to go against your mood and your will and what you know best. So he said, your wife tells you, when you go, take your umbrella with you. That's how he starts. Take your umbrella with you, and you look at the weather. It's actually a clear sky, beautiful weather. It's not even hot. He said, it doesn't make sense what she's saying. So what should you do? Take the umbrella with you. And when people say to you, what are you doing with the umbrella in your hand? You say, it's God's will for me. It's God's will. What is the meaning of this story? He says, this is how you start to work your asceticism, is to submit your will. You don't really have to do your own mood and your own thought. They say, okay, some people would ask me sometimes in the counseling, spiritual counseling, say, Abuna, I want to learn how to be humble. You know, what would the ascetics say about that? I go back in my mind. And the ascetics would say, it's a vain thing. You go and try to practice humility. At the end of the day, you've made a couple of moves. You get so proud of yourself. I made it. Is that humility? No, you're actually getting yourself more and more full of yourself, right? And maybe you've accepted, you've done something, you know, very humble. That's what you think. But what is true humility? True humility is you accept adversities. You accept resistance. You accept somebody to treat you badly. Your wife and children tell you what to do. Your husband and children tell you, and you just actually accept it. So, not me doing it, it's God doing it to me through others. Today we see the story of St. Isaiah, who was the head of a monastery in Egypt, and he had St. Arsenius, who was Greek. He came to be with the monks of Egypt, and he's a very rich man. He came from a very rich place. He was a teacher, a tutor of princes. St. Arsenius sits at the table and he's eating with the rest of the monks. So he started picking, you know, their beans. They used to eat fava beans. And their beans had some bugs in it. They, as ascetics, they don't care. They eat it all together. So he would pick the one that doesn't have the bug and leave the one that has the bug for the rest of the monks to eat. So Saint Isaiah said, I cannot embarrass him. He comes from a very rich people. And he's like doing his best. He came from a very high place socially, and now he is. So we're going to have to teach him something. So he came to one of the monks and said to him, would you accept something for Christ? And the monk said, yes, Father, whatever you do. Sit next to Arsenius and start picking the good beans. So he did. And the monk said, Isaiah came to him, and he slapped him, a very big slap on his face. I said, what are you doing? And the monk said, yes, Father. He said, you're picking the beans and leaving the bad ones for your brothers? Don't do that. That's evil. So Arsenius stopped eating, and he thought to himself, this is for you, Arsenius. They're trying in the community of the monastery to teach and to learn how to control oneself and one desires. When you sit to eat, make sure that everybody else have the best before you start eating yourself. That's asceticism. When you go into a place and they are trying to have some fun and they want to pick a place, be the last one to choose. When you are going to play a game and they don't know which game to pick, be the last one to pick and ask others to choose. This is asceticism. This is the way of virtue. This is how we become a friend of God, who sent his son, and the son came and did not please himself. He had us first in mind, and he became a sacrifice for us. This is the way of God. This is the way of heaven. To him, the glory, Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.